I think some of the big barriers to actually delivering palliative care programs in First Nation communities, one of the biggest ones is jurisdictional issues in terms of health service delivery. So we're kind of stuck between the federal government and the provincial government in terms of delivering health care services. And along with those jurisdictional barriers really becomes an issue of service delivery and of funding. So palliative care delivered through the home and community care program on First Nation communities, palliative care is not considered an essential element of the home care program on First Nations. It's considered a supportive service element. So that's a really, really big barrier, because when it comes to somebody's end of life, or when it comes to the point when they would benefit from a palliative approach, those services aren't there, the funding isn't there. And what people are finding is that they're kind of getting lost in that gap of that care pathway when they're transitioning from the hospital back into the community. In addition to those barriers, I think some of the other barriers are things to do with cultural safety and culturally competent care. A lot of healthcare providers outside the community don't really understand First Nations culture. They don't really understand our norms and protocols and practices. And if care was delivered in their home community, they would have access to all that. They would have access to those practices. They would have access to those people right within their communities. Language could be a barrier. In some of the communities that we work with, people are very fluent in their language. And I've heard a lot of stories that at the end of life, people will always revert back to their traditional language. So if you don't have care providers who can speak your language, it creates a lot of good barriers to end of life. There's a lot of other barriers in terms of not having that family presence around. I'm speaking from my own personal experience in terms of at the end of life, we as Anishinaabe people come together, we have a sense of kinship and family ties that's really, really strong and evident. And you hear that a lot in the healthcare system where they say, we can't have 40 people in the room vigiling beside the person at the end of life. We can only have immediate family members. Well, the concept of immediate family members in First Nations people, and in my family in particular, doesn't just mean mom and dad, brothers and sisters. It's that whole extended family that needs to be there, to be present, to witness, to vigil, to do those ceremonies and those practices, whereby hospital policies and procedures don't allow that. And I think at that time, it can be very difficult for family members to be able to cope with those changes and know how to navigate that system. I provided care to my own mother when she was dying. And having that education and working with the people that I work with and having all those professionals as my colleagues in the field of palliative care, I found it extremely difficult to navigate that system. And when I was going through that with my mother, I thought, if I'm having this much difficulty, how is it for somebody who doesn't have that education, somebody who doesn't know how to access those services, somebody that has those constant barriers? Medications has also been talked about as a barrier in First Nation communities in terms of how to get access to those medications, how to go through that approval and that process in terms of getting those medications, getting it delivered to the First Nation community if there's no pharmacy nearby. Health and well-being of the community is also another big barrier. And when I say health and well-being of the community, I'm talking about in terms of addictions, suicides, multiple trauma and losses in the community. We hear a lot about in the First Nation communities and the communities that we work with is that those unexpected deaths, those suicides, those accidents kind of overshadow the expected deaths. And we hear a lot of stories that people are saying, you know, we're just trying to find a way to keep our young people alive. And that's where our energy is going to, that we can't really afford a lot of time for the people that are very sick or very ill in the community because we're always going through so much trauma and grief and loss. Lack of communication is also another really big issue, and that's lack of communication between healthcare providers, between healthcare providers and families, referral systems from people getting discharged from the hospital back home, and really knowing the culturally appropriate way and the culturally relevant way of approaching those conversations. We talk a lot about advanced care planning in palliative care and how we as palliative care advocates, you know, really advocate for those advanced care planning. But if you're working with a community, a First Nation community, whereby talking about death and dying goes against a lot of those traditional teachings against talking about death and dying, how can you do advanced care planning? How can you have those discussions?